Subscribe to Film Companion for your film fix. Hit the bell icon so you never miss an update.
So Zoya, Vishal, Vic, Kabir, so lovely to have you on Film Companion. You four are, of course, some of the finest directors working today. But you're also here as the Board of Trustees of the Jio Mami Mumbai Film Festivals. Big applause to all of you. You are our wonderful trustees. you know, as festival director, I'm kind of biased and of course, always proud of the festival, but I'm especially proud now because it is the only Indian festival that's been selected for We Are One, which is this massive global online film festival. And before we start chatting, I want to just give our viewers a little bit of a brief on We Are One. So it's a global online film festival organized by Tribeca in New York. It's a 10-day festival running from 29th May to June 7th. Mami has curated four films as part of We Are One. There are two feature films, E Baleu and Nasir, and two shorts, Awake and Nutcut. These films have been curated by our artistic director, Smriti Kiran. Festival is free on YouTube, so everybody needs to go and watch. And the programming will also include sessions with directors such as Bong Joon-ho, Francis Ford Coppola, and Steven Soderbergh. So what is anybody waiting for, right? It's an amazing, amazing feast of cinema. But I thought, since I have four of you here, I want to talk a little bit about the state of the movies right now. You know, Vic, you and I participated in a webinar a couple of weeks ago. And in that, Mr. S.S. Rajamouli was talking about how he sees the pandemic as a sort of creative challenge. He said that when we emerge, budgets will be tighter, but expectations will be higher because people want to see even better stuff and will need even bigger reasons to get out of their homes. Is that something that you can connect with as storytellers? Are you also seeing it as sort of the ultimate creative challenge?
No. Rajamouli, I love what he said. He said that, you know, so today you go into a theater and Salman Khan takes off his shirt and you whistle and you clap for no reason. He predicts that after the pandemic is over, you're going to go inside and you're still going to whistle, but you're going to expect a reason for him to take off his shirt. It's like you're going, because the audience is going to be so tuned into watching, you know, stuff that is more sensible than single screen cinema. I don't necessarily know if that is true. I would love, I mean, and that's the ideal world, right? To actually have sort of commercial movies where things make a lot of sense. That's just that's the best kind of cinema that we can get. I do believe, I mean, on a slightly bummer note, that I do believe that budgets are going to come down because the audiences are, and that trickle effect is going to start to happen downwards, where we're going to, you know, budgets are going to be slashed and then we're going to have to make smaller films. And Zoya and me were just sort of talking about the fact that how we're going to have to really, like, this scaled up stuff that we were looking to do, we're not going to be able to do that, at least for in the near future. It means a lot of us have to go back to school and learn how to shoot on the green screen properly, you know, which maybe in the long run is a great thing. It's like it'll just completely change us, you know, cut down crew sizes, learn the, you know, learn new crafts and learn new ways of filmmaking. But it's going to be a very tough year and a half, I think, at the very least.
Do you think this is, like you said, the time to cut down not just crew sizes, but cut down some of the flap, cut down some of the unnecessary sort of costs that had crept into, that was just a way of life in the Hindi film industry?
Absolutely, 100%. We need to, we have to. I mean, like, you know, and again, this is, we've all been complaining about the fact that why are there always four camera attendants on a set? Why are there always six people with a crane? Why is there one person with every light? Nowhere else in the world does this happen except India, you know? So those are things that have to be done. But at the same time, that is your, that's your day label, right? You can't sort of like go and say, we're going to cut it down. So unions and producers and networks and studios have to all come together and find solutions, saying, okay, if there's 100 people and we're going to cut down your crew sizes by 50%, where are the other 50% working? It means more shows. It means more films. It means being able to spread that work, you know, across more productions and things. But this, I think there's an urgent need for everyone to sit together, the guild and, you know, the distributors, the studios, the Amazons and Netflixes of the world, and really sort of come up with a solution that can help the industry going forward.
So what do you see as the function of the artist at a time like this?
I mean, if you think about it, and now we are talking about people that are not really, you know, scounging for shelter and food and clothing. That's a completely separate chapter. The people that are locked up and in their homes, they all have turned to the arts. That's all everyone's doing. They're either reading a book, they're either watching a film, they want to know what show you're watching, they're listening to music, they're catching up on stuff. So it is of prime importance, you know, because when everything actually goes to shit, that's where you look for solace, for entertainment, for diversion of your mind, for whatever it is, you know, for lifting of spirit, for passing the time, whatever the need be. So I think the arts are like super important. And I think that they kind of reflect what's happening. But taking off from where he said, one thing is the industry and the nuts and bolts of it and how is it going to function and when are we going to be back on our feet and stuff. The other thing is, what is this going to do to narratives? I mean, tomorrow, if I'm making a film that's contemporary, and is it, I don't know what the post-COVID world is. Like, I don't know what that world is. Do people always have masks? Is everyone sanitizing all the time? Has that become part of our life? We don't know. So, and that, does it come into the narrative? How does it come into the narrative? It's pretty interesting. I mean, we are right now, we are in it. So we can only look at it, you know, a little later. But already, like, I'm working on stuff and I'm like, okay, so when am I going to shoot this? And what's the world going to be like? And I'm going to need to adapt this. I need to, you know, you're writing stuff that you know you're going to have to do a post-COVID pass on.
Right.
Because the world's not going to be the same. And thankfully.
Yeah, yeah. So, Vishal and Kabir, is this something you are grappling with? I imagine all the filmmakers here are at least thinking about future. Of course, Kabir, you have a film that's almost ready. But if you're thinking about stories, are you thinking that, like Zoya said, you'll write one version, but then there'll have to be a post-COVID pass on it?
Absolutely. No, I mean, when Zoya was mentioning this, I'm also going through a process. I'm working on one show, which we had started work, say, 6-7 months ago. And now in this lockdown, obviously, we're all having, you know, a relook and discussions on the scripts. And now we're going to shoot this maybe, whatever, 7 months, 8 months, 10 months from now. It'll come out maybe 2 years from now. And we really don't know what two years from now, what the world is going to look like. And if we are saying it's a contemporary story and suddenly all the post-COVID elements are not there, it can start looking weird. It can start looking dated. So it's a, such a dynamic process that we have to, we're in the middle of it.
Yeah.
We have to come out of this and realize what are we coming into? What's the world going to look like? You know, it's very difficult to have clarity on anything. I don't even have clarity, for example, in an earlier question, whether I don't know whether people are going to expect more entertainment. Are people going to expect more sort of sensible cinema? Are people going to be scared and stay away? Or will, like they came out for that bottle of beer, jump onto each other and come running into the theater? I don't know. Are people going to come out scared? Or are people going to come out hungry for more experiences? So it's very difficult because it all deals with human behavior, right? It's ultimately how us as human beings are going to react to this situation. React to the fear that we have now. Will we have that fear 3 months from now? Or will that fear be overtaken by just a need to experience, be entertained, you know, and interact with people?
Vishal, what is your sense? Do you think people will want, you know, sort of difficult narratives that perhaps might help them process what has happened to all of us? Or will they be looking for something that allows them an escape from what is outside?
Yeah, because I just heard that Rajamouli's thing. I think it's a very wishful thinking. The COVID is not going to change the perception of the, you know, the audience. They are still going to whistle on Salman Khan's taking off his shit, and why not? So yeah. Do you think the COVID is going to mature our audience to that they will go and watch True Detective in the theaters? So I think that's a wrong assessment completely. And that's a very wishful thinking. Yeah, but I think I can talk about myself, what I am. I'm a little confused, as everyone is saying, you know, then the story which I have been thinking of or the script I have been working, will it become a period film like 2019? I am making a period film for 2019. Whatever I have thought, I don't know what's going to happen if I'm trying to make it contemporary, how will my two actors kiss, or they will even hold hands will they be talking from a social distancing? I mean, it will be great to explore a subject like that, a film in the times of, you know, social distancing. And I think, as everyone said, that we are part of the storm. So we don't know. Once the storm stops and we come out of it, we'll be able to have a perception or a perspective about it. But the great subjects are going to arrive out of this tragedy. That's a little perverse, but what's happening with the migrants? There'll be hundreds of two-wheeler zameens will come out of it. So, and it's a time for introspection. For me, you know, I am getting to know so many things about myself which I didn't have the time to think about. You know, it's suddenly, you know, it's like you were running in a 200 kilometer per hour and suddenly it's a stop. So you are thinking that, and it's not just you stop, everything around you also had stopped. So I am getting to know so many things about myself, that why I was having such a big office, why I was going to have meetings in, you know, town for a 10 minute, I can do it like on Zoom. So, I mean, and this is superficial things I'm talking about, but very internal things I'm getting to know about myself, that why I was giving just priority to my direction, why I was not concentrating on music, and I'm getting to work on my music. I was not able to, we have a great reference, me and Vikram, you know, for many years I have been trying to master the piece of that Moonlight Sonata by Beethoven. And do you remember, Vikram?
Panch mein na uske agaan mein.
Yeah, nahi uske upar jhagda hua tha mere aur Anurag ka bahut bada. I have a letter from Anurag accusing me. You know, why he hates me, why will he never work with me?
Really? I don't know.
And I just a handwritten letter. And it's like 8 pages long, like a full script. And I have kept that, you know, bahut sambhal ke rakha hai maine use. Maine use pura scan karke one day I'll play Moonlight Sonata for him. Now I'm able to play Moonlight Sonata because of COVID.
That's so cool.
That's amazing. Tell me, you think the of course the stories will change, but what about the telling, the style of telling the stories? You know, because I was just thinking about what happens to a close-up when you're not seeing it on the big screen. You know, does a close-up have less power when it's on a computer screen or it's on a phone? Do those things become different? Because the close-up is such a powerful tool.
But those were happening regardless of the pandemic. People were already consuming film or cinema on their phones. I cannot watch a movie on my phone.
Yeah. I can't. Yeah.
But whatever happens, the big screen is not going to go away.
It can't go away. It's not going to go.
Okay, let's talk about that, because even before the pandemic, there was a very sustained conversation about the future of cinema. This has basically accelerated that conversation. And of course, there's been some great fiery exchanges between the producers and between the multiplex owners. How do you see this unraveling? Not this specific situation. Of course, producers have, you know, money, things that need to be dealt with, and therefore films are going directly to streaming. I don't want to talk about that. I'm saying on a larger scale, how do you see it panning out?
For me, I don't know whether it's a practical reason or how one can define it, but there's something about walking into this dark hall and watching a film with 300...
It's another experience.
I don't think that can ever be replaced.
It can't interchange. And this conversation's happening since, you know, we had DVDs or video
came in.
Yeah, since then, like when satellite television came in, video came in, DVDs came in, and the theater, the home theater came in. They said, now what more do you need for the experience? You have surround sound, you have massive screens, but nothing replaces a cinema, you know, and it's a completely different experience. I can watch a show at home at my time and my leisure, but it's like, to me, reading. It's like reading a book. It's like one chapter, I watch it every night and I can go to sleep. It's a completely different experience, and it's a very personal experience. I can't watch shows with anyone else.
I can't wait for someone else to be free. But a movie is something else. It's a community experience. And it's something that you go into the theater and it's larger than life and nothing can, they're not interchangeable.
And they don't need to be. I don't know why people are talking of them as alternatives. Yeah. People, a large number, in fact, a larger number will ultimately consume it on your phone and your laptops. They will. You can't stop that. But why should it at least let some people have the joy of watching it on a big screen? You know, as filmmakers, I would want to have this, the joy of projecting my work onto the big screen. And then later people will consume it on their laptops and their... So I don't think it's an either or. I don't think we need to get into that argument about if this is getting stronger, will theaters die? I think they can both coexist.
No, it won't. Well, you know, one of my areas of worry and concern is our songs. You know, if we can't have X amount of people on a set, you know, can you recreate a Bidi Jalaile? You know, can you have that sense of energy and crowd and the dancers and the sort of the larger than life sense of it? You know, so will the way we tell our stories change for a little period of time?
I think, yeah, Anupama, I think you're projecting a much, should I say,
dire situation. You are being a Debbie Downer on this interview.
Which is making me question and saying, oh my God, really?
Yeah, forever. As you know that forever and ever till the humanity will exist, we'll never be able to do something like this. No. Why are you being so pessimistic, Anupama?
This too shall pass, and maybe 2 years from now we will have Bidi Jalaile again.
And if we are not able to, we will make them wear the suits and we still have the Bidi Jalaile.
Yeah.
We'll make them wear masks and we'll be more creative in that.
Okay, so before we get into the movies that have been selected for We Are One, I have one more question. You know, you talked about getting back to shoot and what, you know, what that was going to look like. Do any of you have a sense of when you might be comfortable doing that? I know the Producers Guild has put out very extensive guidelines on, you know, what are the safety protocols to be followed. But practically speaking, does anyone have a sense ki ye ho sakta hai?
I personally don't. I have no idea.
I don't think. I think it's going to be something we'll all feel, Anupama. I don't think it's somebody will have to tell us. I think it'll be a palpable feeling that all of us will get. Okay, I think I can step out now. You know, I think I'll put on a mask, my gloves, and I'll go out. And I think that's when I would like to call my crew back. I don't think I'll go with a set of guidelines and say, you know, this government has told me I can do it now. Guys, come back. No. We'll all feel that sense of security. We'll feel that fear going away from us and we'll come back.
Got it. Okay. Now tell me, recommend to me what you would want people to watch from the films that are going to be as part of We Are One. Vishal, can we start with you?
Oh, yeah, I loved E Bale U. You know, I have seen after a long time, I have seen such a beautiful coming, a film like this coming out of India. And I felt so bad that I should have watched it earlier. It is such a beautiful film. And I think that the film I recommend. And I love Awake. And I love the actress the most in that. I mean, Ishika is... I just love Ishika. I mean, I didn't know that Ishika is such a fine actor. And kitna achha kaam kiya usne, oh my God. And the film is also very beautiful. But Ishika is to die for in that. But E Wale U is a very, very deep film. I think I'm very affected with that film. And these kind of films should actually also come up. And, you know, these kind of films should have a great support from all of us.
So, Vic, you cannot choose Awake, but what would you recommend?
E Wale U, 100%. I saw it at Mami and I haven't been so... It's my favorite, and I've been saying my favorite Hindi film of last... My favorite film of last year, actually, from 2019, because it's so... It's funny. It's like my biggest takeaway was like, my God, this is India. This character of Anjani is India. He's stupid. He's foolish. He's arrogant. He's all those things. Yet he's Jugadu. Yet he's a genius at some level. I'm like, it's so, you cannot like it. And Prateek has really done an amazing job of that, you know, and it's superbly funny. It's really touching. So I love E Bale U 100%. But I also love Naseeb. It's a, Nasir is a more classical festival film. It's a more classical art film. It's a film that requires patience. It requires a certain amount of, which is so difficult to do in these times, because if you're not strapped to a chair watching it on a big screen, it's very difficult, sadly. And that's where, you know, so theaters are not just for the big blockbusters. They're also meant for the personal cinema. But Nasir is beautiful. It's very tragic. It's very, I mean, it's so innocent.
It is. You know, and the, it's lovely.
Just the tragedy of like politics and religion, you know, disrupting innocent lives is part of it. So I mean, both these films, I love both these films. Awake also, I love. I have to.
As producer, you cannot select your own film.
Okay.
Zoya, what did you like?
I just loved Ibaleu. I had no idea what it was. And I have to say that I thought it was, the title was in another language that I didn't understand.
Even I thought so.
So yeah. I was like, okay, so it's going to be subtitled, and I'm, you know, and I put it on, and then I'm like, oh, okay. And when it started, I'm like, oh my God, this is, I had no idea this job existed. I didn't know people did that. I mean, I've lived in Latinx, yeah, for a bit. So I was like, what's going on? And it was such a, I mean, it's a satire, so yeah, it's funny and it's all that, but it was such a pointed political comment.
Yeah.
You know, it was fantastic the way it was done, and it just like sliced you. It was very, very good.
Yeah.
And the actor was outstanding. The
lead. Yeah.
He's outstanding, that guy.
It almost felt like, you know, it's like a documentary, like he doesn't even know there's a camera.
Yeah.
It feels like that, you know, it's happening in reality. It doesn't feel like a film, yeah.
No, he is actually fantastic. Like, I'm really looking forward to, like, I don't know what kind of guy he is. Like, I want to meet him, like an actor. Like, I just don't, you know, you don't know anything about him. He was superb in it. Yeah, I thought he was just amazing. And I liked both the shorts that I saw. I loved Ishika, like I told you. But I found Awake quite dark also. You know, there's this whole, like, love story, but it's kind of like, twisted. Not because of what she's doing, but because of, on some level, I mean, can we talk about this? Is it going to be spoilers?
Let's not spoil it, but tell me, but you liked it because it's dark and twisted, or did it make you uncomfortable?
No, it didn't make me uncomfortable. What made me uncomfortable was actually not the obvious of what was going on. What made me uncomfortable, it was like suddenly she seemed to have him under control and do with him and what she wanted.
Correct.
Like, she dressed him and made his hair the way she wanted. That was really weird, you know, like, to me. So I mean, taking off this like great wife who's doing all this, but there was actually a really, like,
there was a dark undertone too.
Very very dark undertone, because it was suddenly like she's dressing him like he wouldn't. She's made him something else, which was dark.
And Kabir, for you?
Yeah, I think, like everybody said, I mean, for me, Nasir is a very, very important film. I think Nasir in today's context especially resonates much more. I mean, again, without, you know, giving any spoilers, you just don't know, you know, what's coming, and you're lulled into this, just watching this adorable man about his everyday life and the dangers I never seen, they only heard, which is so amazing about that film. It's there, it's loud, but you really don't know, is that coming or is that just part of the sort of design? And then, of course, you know, you realize, okay, that's again, it's difficult to talk about that film without giving away some spoilers. But yes, and I think in today's context, Nasir is a very, very important film. So it made really sort of work hugely for me. But Eve is, of course, delightful. So I grew up and I sort of, 25, 30 years of my life, I lived in Delhi, in central Delhi, in the areas they've shot. So I've seen this. I've seen the Monkey Menace. I've been part of the various sort of scares that have come through the Monkey Menace in Delhi. You know, and in fact, when I was a child, they used to use the langur. Which is now been replaced, and therefore these monkey catchers have been brought in. So there was this personal connect for me also. And just the way the story's been told, the way it's been shot, the sound design, it's so natural. The performances, the way, and just layers and layers and layers of comment, you know, on society and so many sort of the politics. It's really enjoyable. I think all four are great. You know, they are, I think these are great. It's a great selection.
Even Ratkat was super disturbing.
Very disturbing. Okay, guys, before I let you go, just in a line, why should we care about film festivals? Since you all do, you give your time to it.
Zoya is the expert at doing this kind of stuff. Zoya, please.
I can start. I became a filmmaker. Huh. I became a filmmaker because of the film festivals. When I attended my first film festival, I saw Kieslowski's Decalogue. And that's where I realized the power of the cinema. Yeah. So that's why the film festivals are so... I mean, I would never been... a filmmaker.
When you're a filmmaker and being at a festival and what that entails, and then just being audience and being at a festival and what that entails. I mean, it's just, if you like film, it's like movie paradise. It's like Disneyland.
Yeah.
It's like heaven. You know what I mean? It's like you, people are hanging out. You can meet people. You can meet colleagues. You can talk. It's a cultural melting pot. You see films from everywhere. You're the first to see them. You actually dictate what the future of a film is, because when it gains buzz at a festival, it changes the trajectory of a movie. So as you're the first audience that actually gives it wings. And I mean, it's got such energy, you know, and you can go into talks, you can come. I mean, it's just, it's, you know, if you're attending a festival, you're there from morning to night. You're just there. It's Disneyland. Yeah.
It's just such a great celebration. I mean, the word, it's not called a film meeting, film conference. It's called a film festival because
it's
not a celebration, right? So the word festival itself tells you you're going to go and celebrate cinema. And for a filmmaker, you know, what better way to spend a day than be at a film festival?
Yeah. But don't you remember that year we were at Cannes? I mean, if you had done this to Dibakar, me, Anurag and Karan, champagne would have come. I'm not joking. It was like there were all these tents of different countries, and you just went in wherever, met filmmakers. I mean, wherever you turned, there was a tub of champagne. It was just a big week-long party. And you get to watch movies, you're dressing up, you're going... It's amazing.
It is amazing.
They make you feel special, right? It's just like, even for me, my debut film, Kabul Express, it premiered at Toronto. You just feel like feel like God, you know. You feel the kind of the way they pamper you.
Yeah.
As Zoya said, you know, the champagnes and the parties and the dressing up, it's pure celebration.
Yeah. And Vikas has had his name in front of the palais next to Bharad. What did that feel like, man? What are film festivals? What do they mean to you?
No, they are the most, I mean, what Kabir said, the purest form of watching cinema. If you're a film lover or a filmmaker or something, there is no purer way of watching a movie than at a film festival, because you're away from all the commercials, the ads and all that sort of stuff. You're just there. It's all about the movie. It's all about the makers. It's all about that. And I think as a maker, it's wonderful because you're front and center. Your film is front and center, and the respect that everybody gives you. But as a watcher, it's just gorgeous to watch in, walk in and watch these four films in the purest way possible, with the purest audience possible. There's nothing better. It's like the all-you-can-eat buffet, except it's all just really great food.
And there's no interval either.
There's no interval.
Yeah. And at least now we should negotiate with our theater owners who are, you know, that at least please spare us this interval. You can sell your popcorn later and before or after.
Correct. One more thing to think about over the pandemic. Interval hona chahiye ki nahi? People are eating popcorn and chocolate. Yeah, there's no interval. It's not like people don't eat popcorn in other countries.
Yeah.
Correct.
And
correct.
They are like, hamari pura aisi ki taisi kar dete hain film ki yaar.
Yeah.
Pura, and us pe negotiate bhi nahi karte. Abhi bol rahe hain ki sir filmmakers aake film lao aur dikhao.
Yeah.
जब हम पॉपकॉर्न के लिए मना करते हैं तो भगा देते हैं वो, जैसे वो लंगूर भगा रहा था बंदरों को, ऐसे बताते हैं क्या मतलब, व्हाट द हेल इज दिस यार, ये तो होना चाहिए ना कम से कम, कितनी गंदी बात है।
But I totally agree with Vishal. I think the filmmakers should have an option. They should decide. There are some filmmakers who write with an interval in their mind.
And some films need that. Some films need that also.
So I think it should be the filmmaker's choice. I want an interval. I don't want an interval. I might write a film where I feel, okay, isme main interval dunga, and I want an interval. Or I might write a film where I say, I don't want an interval in this. I just want it to go straight. But that's a good point, Vishal. We should take this up. ये हमें फिर वापस लानी है तो हमें
दिस इज द टाइम टू दिस इज द ओनली टाइम टू नेगोशिएट
या
Guys, so clearly lots is going to change. Even the interval may or may not change. Yes. So listen, I'm not a pessimist. I'm very excited. And I believe that cinema is here forever. It's not even a debate for me. So thank you. And you know, thank you for putting all your might behind Mami. Thank you for all your support.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. Thank you so much.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye.